Kayla can scan everything up a few seconds before we call the meeting to order. Is everyone ready? All right, good evening, everyone. I don't have a gavel, so we're going to call the meeting to order at 6:01 p.m. This is the meeting for the Community Advisory Council for Iolero. And if we could just go around the table and just state your name and the district that you represent or your position related to the CAC, and we'll start on that end.
Sean Jones, I'm a lieutenant with the Sheriff's Office and Professional Standards Bureau.
Darnell Bowen, first Iolero meeting.
Thank you. And you're the at large.
At large, yes, thank you.
Tom Rose, Division 2, District 2, David Reitman's district.
Nancy Pemberton, District 5.
Lorena Barrera, District 3.
John Alden, Iolero Director.
Lisa Camacho, Community Engagement Manager for Iolero.
Nathan Solomon, District 1.
Thank you. And then we'll turn it over to Vice Chair Pemberton to read the commitment to civil engagement.
Max Pearl, District 5.
Oh, and before, I guess I have like short-term memory loss. I just talked about this. We have Matt attending virtually, Max attending virtually.
Yeah.
And I think the new rules for the Brown Act have changed. So you have to state the reason that you're attending virtually, and then we have to do a vote to allow you to attend virtually.
I am sick. I have a cold. I have a bad cold.
Okay, thank you. So we'd like to have Max fully participate in our meeting. So can I get a motion to have Max participate virtually?
So moved.
I'll second. Okay, thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you. And no one, there are no noes or no abstentions. So thank you, Max. Okay, now we will move on to the commitment to civil engagement.
Good evening, everyone. All are encouraged to engage in respectful communication that supports freedom of speech and values diversity of opinion. CAC members, staff, and the public are encouraged to, one, create an atmosphere of respect and civility where CAC members, county staff, and the public are free to express their ideas within the time and content parameters established by the Brown Act and the CAC's standard parliamentary procedures. Two, adhere to time limits for each individual speaker in order to allow as many people as possible the opportunity to be heard on as many agenda items as possible. Three, establish and maintain a cordial and respectful atmosphere during discussions. Four, foster meaningful communication free of attacks of a personal nature and or attacks based on age, ability, disability, class, education level, gender identity, occupation, race and or ethnicity, sexual orientation. But number five, listen with an open mind to all information, including dissenting points of view regarding issues presented to the CAC. And finally, recognize that it is sometimes difficult to speak at meetings, and out of respect for each person's perspective, allow speakers to have their say without comment or body gestures, including booing, whistling, or clapping. Moreover, our design team alliance is that all are encouraged to engage in respectful, non-disruptive communication that supports freedom of speech and values diversity of opinion. Our design team alliance is a list of norms which describe the way CAC wants to show up and to be in community while modeling collaborative behavior. We request that CAC members, staff, and the public follow the CAC's agreed upon design team alliance, which is be tough on topic, not on people, respect others' perspective, respect time, practice active listening, be open-minded, speak to others as you would like to be spoken to, honor freedom of speech, and call each other in.
Thank you, Vice Chair Hamilton. Now we'll move on to item two, the approval of the April 30 meeting minutes. Are there any questions on the minutes from CAC members? Okay. Do you have any public comment in regards to the minutes? Seeing none, if there are no points of discussion, can I get a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And then
I abstain. Abstain.
Okay. Thank you, Max. Okay. We'll move on to item three. And we'll start off with the introduction of Darnell Bowen.
Well, if you don't mind, I'll say a couple things first. So as folks who are watching this meeting or here may know, Measure P created some rules for how we point folks to this body, the Community Advisory Council. And in short, we have 11 members, two from each of the supervisorial districts. Each of them are appointed by the member of the Board of Supervisors for that district. And then one, the 11th member, is appointed by the Isle Arrow director. And that position has been vacant since I came on. And I'm very happy to say that we have found Darnell Bowen to fill that role. He's very graciously agreed to do it. There are a lot of great things that Darnell could be doing for the county. So we're lucky to have him here. And one of the things that has impressed me about Darnell is his open-mindedness, his ability to listen. I can tell from conversations I've had with him that when people with differing viewpoints from his own speak to their perspective, he's really able to hear them and appreciate how that might be different from the way he looks at the world, but still take that into account as he's making decisions. I appreciated that Darnell came to our retreat and got involved with us and talked about what some of our priorities ought to be back in February. I also want to thank Supervisor Gore, who introduced us and suggested we might enjoy working together. And that was a great help from the board and from Supervisor Gore in particular. And I'm just really very excited to have Darnell here. And Darnell, I should say, one of the rules of engagement that we agreed to at the retreat, you may recall, is first names. So I don't mean to be casual, but that's our way here. So I'm trying to invite you to do the same. And if you don't mind, maybe say a few things about yourself.
Well, thank you, John. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. Thank you all for this opportunity, truly. Darnell Bowen, I am a 20-plus year resident of Sonoma County. I moved here following grad school to work in the tech industry and worked on the Hill in Falcon Grove for a long time, met my wife, and we got married, and so she's from Hillsburg. We have four children all together. We have two older kids and then a set of twins, boy girls, in Windsor. So that's where we live, the town of Windsor. We're very passionate about this community. We are a biracial couple. We have BIPOC kids, and the intersectionality of policing as it relates to people of color is very important. And so I worked, listened, talked, moved, rattled the cage where I can to make sure that all policing, which I absolutely support, is fair to everyone. This is my country too. And so I'm thankful for the opportunity to work on this great board and move some agendas along at the policy level, which is how things get done. And so I thank John for the many, many conversations we had over the last several months as he answered my questions, and he was very quite patient with me. And I felt like it was the right thing to do to just ask questions over the several. It's not a quick thing, right? Because you want to make sure that it's the right thing. And so in my not so spare time, my wife and I run a nonprofit here in Sonoma County called Nuestra Comunidad. We do outreach to the community, focusing on disaster preparedness, 911 outreach, and we run a whole host of health and wellness programs, again, focusing on Sonoma County with an emphasis on our underserved populations. And so again, I'm very much happy to be a part of this board. I look forward to the work that the IOLARL/CAC can do to bring to fruition the desires of the majority of our residents here. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
For
Thank you very much. Welcome, Darnell. Thank you. Okay, we'll move on. We also wanted to announce that we still have vacancies on the CAC. There are currently three, one in the first, one in the second, and one in the third. So if you know anyone interested, please encourage them to apply. Thank you.
Can I just, in effect, someone is trying to log into the Zoom and it says that the web link is expired, and I just tried it on my phone from the agenda that's online for today, and it gave me the same message. So that could be why we have 0 attendees.
I'm working on it.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you for that. No, we really appreciate it.
Could we take maybe a recess for a moment and then start up again once we fix that problem?
Yeah, I think that would be appropriate. So it's 6:11. We'll take a short recess, check back in like 5 minutes to see if we've been able to address that. Thank you and apologies for that.
That's because he thought the green
Max couldn't hear us.
Frozen, so.
Max?
Yes. He's muted himself.
Max, are you able to hear us?
I can hear you now, yes.
Okay, perfect. Maybe I wasn't speaking loud enough. Okay, sorry for the technicalities. It looks like we had the incorrect link on our agenda. So that information has been shared with members in the audience from the public who have access to people trying to get into our meeting. We apologize for this. And we do want to note that we encourage everyone to attend in person for any issues occurring via Zoom. We do have a section in the agenda that says the CAC's public meetings will not be canceled if any technical problems occur during the meeting. We do apologize for the error, but want to encourage members to attend in person. So we will proceed, and we were on item number 4. And we don't have any correspondence to report to the public at this time. So now we will proceed to item number 5.
All right. Item number 5 is the director's report from Maya Laro. As we discussed earlier, we have Darnell Bowen as our new member. Very happy about that. And we are continuing to work with the Board of Supervisors around the other CAC vacancies we have. I do think we have someone picked for the first and still need someone for the second and the third. And I know that many CAC members have terms that expire this year. As you might recall, all the CAC members have 2-year terms, and it just happens that a lot of you were appointed 2 years ago this summer. We'll need to be making sure we're communicating about whether people are renewing or not. It's my understanding that our chair, Lorena, sorry, I was about to use your last name. Try not to do that.
It's okay.
Is renewing. And so thank you for that. It'll be great to have you here for another 2 years. For the rest of the folks here, you keep us posted about your plans. If you want to renew, certainly hope to hear that. And if you don't, the sooner that you tell us, the easier it is to find new people. This past month, I had an opportunity to talk to the Regional Training Center, which is the police academy for a variety of agencies here in Sonoma County and in other places, and enjoyed talking to them about police oversight and ILRO, and got a pretty positive response from them. One thing I was really encouraged to see there was that the class of recruits they have currently, more than half of them speak Spanish fluently. And I asked about why that was. I've never seen such high figures for Spanish fluency, even though departments really look for that skill. And part of the answer I got was that state laws recently changed such that one does not have to be a citizen of the United States to be a peace officer in California anymore. That used to be a requirement statewide. And so that has made it easier to recruit people with a variety of different immigration statuses. And therefore, you tend to get people in the application pool who had some experience in their life in another country, or maybe have some other reason why they're in the US but are not yet a citizen, but have more experience with other cultures. So in addition to there being a high rate of Spanish fluency, they had several other languages that were spoken by members of the group. And so it was by far the most diverse class they'd ever had by language fluency. And they expected that to continue because of that changing state law. So I thought that was really fascinating and encouraging. At our next meeting, I expect to be able to talk to you about letters of agreement between the county and applicable unions about implementation of Measure P. I think we're about done with that. I was hoping to have that tonight, but a couple technical last I's to dot and T's to cross. So I look forward to talking to you about that in my next presentation. Last week, we had a budget workshop in front of the Board of Supervisors. For those of you who followed the county's budget process, the budget workshops are an opportunity for the board to explore broad policy issues that come up at each department that might be affected by budget or the budget could affect, so that when they get to budget hearings a couple months from now in June, they already have a foundation about understanding the broader strokes of the budget. Our budget presentation was in some ways easier than in past years because Measure P guarantees us a certain funding level. And I think a fair short summary of the conversation we had there with the board was that we're coming up on an exciting period at ILARO where for probably the first time we have ability to implement Measure P in its entirety. And also we're very close to having full staffing at ILARO. And so for those two things in combination, I don't think we've ever had before. And because we've had some vacancies over the last year, I thought we should spend next fiscal year finding out what it looks like when we have full staffing and full powers and see if those actually match up or not. So for that reason, I didn't propose any significant change to the budget for this next year. And so it was a short but very positive conversation. And we'll have another budget presentation in June in front of the Board of Supervisors that I think will be pretty similar. The Wednesday night markets in Santa Rosa are starting up again. And so Lizette has already gotten us set up with a couple of nights. We're not going to be there every Wednesday, but we'll be there for some of the Wednesdays starting this week, right, Lizette?
Yeah, later.
Yeah, that'll be very exciting. So I know that's a favorite event and has really heavy attendance, so we're looking forward to that. This weekend, we're going to go over to the town of Sonoma. There's a Cinco de Mayo festival that's going on there around midday and table there. There was a Dia de los Niños over the weekend here in Santa Rosa. We went to that also. I got to give Lizette a lot of credit for bringing her Nino. And he had a good time, I think. It seemed like he was running around, even though it was a little warm sometimes.
Yes.
Yes, a little warm. And I also noticed that the Sonoma County Sheriff's Office had a lot of personnel there. And there were also folks from Santa Rosa Police Department and the California Highway Patrol. So it was definitely an opportunity for community to talk to law enforcement and vice versa. We are starting up a project with Wine Country Radio to do some ads about ILARO, who we are and what we do. You might know that group of radio stations because they supervise a whole series of Spanish language radio stations. And we thought that that might be an effective way to get word out better to Spanish speakers in Sonoma County about the work we do in ILARO. So these are going to be introductions, pieces about who we are. The county's been putting together short videos as well about different agencies. They can each give a couple of minutes to explain who they are for use on our websites and places. So we filmed that recently in Spanish and in English. I'm looking forward to those coming out over the next month. You might see some links from us. So you can take a look at some of those videos. We are working on changing parts of the ILARO office. There is not as good of a space as we would like to be able to do interviews in the office. And since we now have this ability to do investigations in certain kinds of cases, we want to have a secure and confidential interview space. So we're working on making that change. That might mean that at some point over the summer, our office might be closed for a few weeks while that remodel is happening, in which case we'll do all our work remotely. But we'll try to get the word out as best we can about that, make sure it's on our website, should that come to pass. The county has also asked that all departments try to alter their branding and publicity to adhere to a common standard across all county departments. If you take a look at all the logos, for example, from all the county departments, you might not realize that any of them have anything to do with each other. So, and honestly, a question we do get at ILARO is, are you part of the county or are you my attorney? And there is some lack of clarity sometimes about who's part of the county and who isn't. So we'll be working on that process as well this summer and probably have some new, say, business cards or other branding material like the logo that you see on our agendas, like the meeting tonight. We'll keep you posted how that goes. Tomorrow is a very special meeting that the Board of Supervisors is having. It's all about mental health issues. They're calling it the Mental Health Workshop. I know that generally speaking, the way in which the county responds to mental health crises and provides mental health services, the topic that's come up here several times. And so I want to make sure to get the word out that's available by Zoom and also in person. My understanding is you have to register online if you want to go in person, but that's all available at the Board of Supervisors website. Those are the items that I have for the report tonight. Any questions?
Any questions from CAC members? Go ahead, Derek.
I'm just curious on the outreach that you're doing on the tabling.
Yeah.
So is that is that just normally the staff? Who supports that in the staffing aspect?
Well, first, I want to give a shout out to Lizette, who puts in an incredible amount of time and effort to do those. They're usually evening and weekend events, right? So she's quite the busy person. And I also have to give some credit to her son, who almost always shows up at these and is a very effective tabler. So those are the two lead staff. But then in addition to that, we do try to get all the other ILRO staff to go at least a little bit. I try to go to those as much as I can. I bring my son, but he's 13, so he's not very helpful with tabling, just kind of sullen on his phone in the background. So sorry, Eric. So that said, it's always great to have CAC members there. And one of the duties and roles of the CAC is to do outreach. We're putting together a standing committee about outreach to focus on how we might do that. So we always get word out to the CAC members that you can come and be part of the tabling efforts. And I think just about everybody here has done that at least a few times since I've been on board. So Darnell, we're going to have you come to something. You get to pick what?
Very well. Thank you.
Yeah. Sure. Other questions?
Was that already going to send us the list of the days for Wednesday night markets?
Yes.
Perfect.
And, you know, since you ask about that, we are talking to some other departments in the county about trying to figure out if we can get enough people together to staff a booth at the county fair this year. It's in early August. I know that's not the usual time of year, but for a variety of reasons, that's when the county had to set it this year. And one of the asks that the county fair has for us is, we're going to run a table, they'd really like it to be there all the time. You know, doesn't make a lot of sense for the county fair to give us a table if we're not actively using it. But that's a really big time commitment. We don't have the staff at ILRO, even with the help of the CAC, to staff, you know, a fair booth for 10 hours a day for 10 days, right? So we've been talking to some other departments about sharing a county booth. So there'd be a booth for a series of county agencies and bring that together. So I expect for those of you on the CAC, you know, we'll be asking you in the near future if you have some time to help out at the county fair. I'm told that every fair booth comes with at least some tickets. So can't guarantee everybody gets into the fair necessarily for free, but I think if you're tabling, you got to get it for free. So we'll be in touch about that probably a little bit more at our next meeting.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? We will open it up to public comment. If you have any comments in relation to the director's report, and just stand up and you'll have 3 minutes. Seeing none, we'll bring it back to the council. Any last points to bring up? Okay, thank you for that report. Now we'll move on to item 6, Sheriff's Liaison Report.
I should mention that our fire liaison was Andy Cash. I understand he's not gonna be our liaison moving forward. I know Sean Jones is here tonight for one of the items that we're going to have on a little bit about HR. If you haven't met Sean Jones, he's lieutenant over the Internal Affairs Division. So at ILRO, we talk to him pretty frequently and also about other things of professional standards. And Lieutenant, if there's anything else you want to say?
No. Well, thanks, John. And thanks for having me back. I know it's been a few months. I am by no means an expert in personnel and our personnel group. I don't work in there and I never have, and I don't manage that unit, but I'll do my best to answer questions. If there's any questions regarding recruitment, anything along those lines, I know, I think HR, I don't know what order you're supposed to be giving your presentation, but I don't have a prepared presentation, so I'll just a question and answer at this point.
The next item we have on the agenda is the presentation about recruiting and hiring at the Sonoma County Sheriff's Office. And I'll introduce our speakers about that here in a moment, and they're there. But I think that's our liaison report for tonight.
Yeah, I'm back.
Thank you. Any questions from CAC members? Any public comment?
Are you going to be the permanent liaison?
Yeah.
Or
yeah, unless we have a shuffle of assignments in the office.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll move on to our first business item, which is a presentation on recruiting and hiring. And we have HR conducting the presentation, and that you can come sit up here if you'd like.
And if you don't mind, I'll introduce our first couple speakers as soon as they get set up and they're ready to go.
I have a 13-year-old as well.
He confessed later that it was loud, but it didn't look like
that. I can't believe you got a confession.
Get you another chair.
And then
I can hit the X on that. That's okay. I'm gonna move this down. And I apologize, I'm used to having a mouse, so.
We have with us tonight. A couple people from HR. I want to introduce Spencer Keywood, who's going to be giving part of this presentation, and Amy Krause, who I think will be giving some presentation as well, right? And I've been working with the two of them over the last month to, or actually a couple of months now, to put together this presentation, because the CAC had identified at the retreat that understanding how the sheriff's office hires and how that affects ultimately culture and diversity amongst sheriff's office employees was important to the CAC. So this is the beginning of your introduction to CAC members to those processes, which honestly can be pretty complicated. And I want to flag at the beginning that from my perspective, these rules tend to be complicated because over time, counties like ours have developed preferences about how to hire people and whom to hire and what really helps us ensure that the people we're hiring are qualified and are going to do a good job. So on the one hand, it's a lot of material and it can take some time to learn. On the other hand, every single one of the rules or processes or steps that we're going to be learning about are ones that came from somewhere. It came from a legitimate, thoughtful concern about how we should be hiring. That said, I think it's always good to have fresh eyes like yours on these systems. And so we can provide some feedback to the sheriff's office, to HR, to the Civil Service Commission about ways you think maybe these processes could be different or better given today's concerns. So I hope you'll listen with some open ears and think carefully about all the pros and cons of the things you're hearing about, but also in the long run, over the next few months, as we put together an ad hoc about this process and start delving into it in even more depth with future presentations, also use your creativity to let us know how these systems could be changed to better meet the community expectation. And so today's our first. So Spencer and Amy, take it away.
Good evening, I should say. My name is Spencer Keywood. I'm Deputy Human Resources Director. Nice to meet you all. Thank you all so much for having us here. And with me is Amy Krause, she's one of the HR analysts in the Human Resources Office. And Amy's the HR analyst on the recruitment and classification team that works directly with the Sheriff's Office and supports their recruitment efforts. So we're here, as John said, to provide you with an overview of our HR processes. Before we get started, just to give you a little bit of clarity, there are really two stages as far as the recruitment process goes at the County of Sonoma. There's the first stage in the process, which is the HR process. So we work with the sheriff's office to develop the job announcement, and then we post the recruitment and we accept applications. We then screen for qualifications. We conduct an examination process, and then we refer candidates to the sheriff's office for the next stage in the process, which is the interview process, background, pre-employment steps, and ultimately the hiring and the onboarding process. So it is a bit of a bifurcated process. What we're going to focus on with you tonight is that first half of the process that human resources is responsible for. And Max, if you can't hear me at all, please do let me know and I can make sure that I speak up. So let's go ahead, if we can move to the first slide, please, Amy.
Okay. Right. Yeah.
Okay. So there are huge foundational concepts I want to make sure that everyone has awareness of as we kind of lay the groundwork from the recruitment standpoint. Our county is divided into a classified and an unclassified service. We have a civil service ordinance that was voted on by members of the public back in 1950. As a result of the civil service ordinance, we have our civil service rules, which were established, and we have a civil service commission who oversees those rules and those processes. And those rules and those processes really define terms of employment at the county. We look at how our recruitments are conducted, our job classifications, what's required to be in a job classification, how long a recruitment needs to be posted for at a minimum standpoint, the fact that we're screening for qualifications. It dictates the different types of examination processes we can use. Then it also covers things such as probationary periods, disciplinary processes, if we have layoffs at all. So that's all covered by the civil service rules. The administration of our civil service system is based on the principle that employment and promotion are merit-based for the purpose of obtaining the highest efficiency and assuring the best qualified persons shall be employed by for service at the county. Our civil service ordinance, as I said, was voted on by the people in 1950. Any amendments we want to make to the civil service ordinance need to be voted on by the public as well. We do not have the ability to make changes to our civil service ordinance without going out for a vote. The board has very limited ability to make administrative changes to it. Our civil service rules, however, those are under the purview of the Civil Service Commission. We do have the ability to make edits to our civil service rules. We do have to engage with our unions and go through meet and confer processes. We can't make any unilateral changes to the civil service rules. One of the processes we actually have that we're focused on for this coming fiscal year 23-24, is actually going to be an evaluation of our civil service rules and our examination processes and our job classifications to identify if we have any artificial barriers in place that are impacting individuals' abilities to apply, compete, and be hired by the County of Sonoma. So kind of a good timing from a CAC standpoint, that is actually one of our high priority projects for this coming fiscal year that will be starting in July. As far as other considerations we have, as I said, we hire people on the basis of merit. Merit system supports hiring the most qualified candidates rather than people who are friends with the hiring manager. This goes back to Andrew Garfield and some changes that happened with the civil service system back in the 1800s. We also have a number of legal considerations that we have to be mindful of. There's Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, which prohibits discrimination. We have the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, which is the federal body that enforces Title VII. So we need to make sure that we're not having any discriminatory treatment or practices in our hiring process. We also have to ensure that the qualifications that we have for our positions have a bona fide occupational qualification. So that means that the qualifications have to relate to essential job duties and they can't be arbitrary qualifications for positions. So these are all the different types of regulations and laws that we have to apply to or abide by as part of our civil service and then as our legal examination and hiring practices and processes.
And I would just okay. Along with that, particularly with the sheriff's office and we have some other law enforcement agencies in the county, is that we have to also, our specifications, our job classifications, have to also include or be considerate of BSCC and post regulations as well. So those are some of the other considerations that become our foundational concepts.
Could you say what BSCC?
Oh, sorry, it's the Bureau. Tell me if I get this right. Of Standards and
Board of State Board Community Corrections.
Thank you.
So the positions in the jail. So while the law enforcement positions have the Commission on Peace Officers, Standards and Training post, the correctional deputy positions, they fall under the purview of the Board of State and Community Corrections. And so we have to comply. Thank you. Good point. Yes. We have to make sure that we are complying with their regulations as well.
So, job classifications.
So when we're looking at different positions at the county, we classify jobs. of a common nature into classifications. And so what that means, it's the process by which jobs of a common nature with which similar duties and responsibilities are grouped together for the purpose of assignment and appropriate pay ranges. And what we look at when we're talking about classifications is we're looking at the nature and the scope and the level of duties and responsibilities of the position, how the positions relate to each other, the supervision, what's given, the supervision given and received, the ability to exercise independent judgment, those educational training and experience requirements, and then any physical requirements. What we have at the county is we have a classification system that's approximately 860 job classifications. So we try to emphasize on broad classifications wherever possible, given the size of the county, which is over 4,000 FTE. We do have over 800 different job classifications that we use. But we do try to broadly classify positions. Some of the positions at the sheriff's office, which I think the CAC is most interested in, that we're going to kind of dig into a little bit deeper tonight, is we have our comms dispatcher. That's our 911 dispatcher. And that's at a 1-2 level. And when I mention these 1-2s, and these mean they're alternately staffed. So the one is the entry level, in which someone can be hired off of the street with little experience or, you know, possessing those minimum qualifications. And then they can be alternately promoted to the journey level upon meeting the qualifications of the higher level and demonstrating experience at that higher level. So that we've got comms dispatcher 1-2. We also have correctional deputy 1-2. And then we have deputy sheriff. And that is a deputy sheriff trainee, and then deputy sheriff 1 and the deputy sheriff 2. The trainee are those individuals who are going into the academy. At the end of the academy, they're being promoted to the deputy sheriff 1. And then with time and experience, they can become deputy sheriff 2. So those are the different classifications that we want to spend a little bit of time talking to you about tonight. By all means, as you're having conversations at the CAC, if there are other classifications that you'd like us to provide you with information about, we can certainly do that. But this is kind of where we're going to focus our time on this evening.
Yeah, and I would just add on the alternately staffed, what that means is upon entry into any position in the county, you typically need to go through a competitive recruitment process. But if it's alternately staffed, it means you don't have to apply again and go through a competitive recruitment. It's kind of seen as the same series, and you get to be promoted, like you said, when you have sufficient skills and you're ready to promote and meet the qualifications for the next step up. So rather than going through that competitive recruitment.
And just to add to that, departments are always allocated at the highest level. So they always have the ability to hire at that highest level. And then they hire people at the lower level so that they can get the time and experience and kind of work their way up. But at the end of the day, they're always allocated at that 2 level. When you look at any kind of budget reports at all, or in the back of the budget book, you'll always see them allocated at the 2 level. You won't see them allocated at the training level or the 1 level.
Okay. Now my turn to talk a little bit. These might look familiar for some colleagues, for our lieutenant that's here tonight. So we wanted to dig in a little bit on the minimum qualifications for the first step into the series. So we do open recruitments for our entry level positions, and we also open recruitments for lateral. But we thought for your lateral, meaning maybe you're from another agency, moving to the area, interested in taking advantage of some of the recruitment tools that I'll talk about. So those are the laterals. But for tonight, we thought most of our employees come in at the entry level, and so we wanted to focus on that. So starting at the top with the communications dispatcher, the minimum qualifications to that in central HR, that's Spencer and me, along with our colleagues, they were looking to ensure that somebody has the minimum qualifications. And so that's what we're screening on. So for a communications dispatcher 1, there's really 2 primary qualifications to be first considered. And that is that they need to be a high school graduate or have earned their GED. And they need to essentially, in the minimum qualifications initially, tell us that they have the ability to type at a corrected speed of 45 words per minute. Now, there's another step in this process where they get to be assessed to see if they really can meet that qualification. So then I just noted on here that for communications dispatcher, if you look at the specification for this position, it also talks about that they'd like for people to have some experience essentially taking listening to communications and simultaneously entering that data into a computer. That's not that easy to do, to be able to listen, process, and type at the same time. Then deputy sheriff trainee, again, you need to be a high school graduate or receive your GED. This one's different. You have to have, you need to possess a valid driver's license. No felony convictions or be under formal probation supervision. Our minimum qualifications currently say that you need to be a US citizen or permanent resident who has applied for citizenship. And then this last one, number five, this is a really interesting one. So this actually is not listed in our current minimum qualifications. The fact that you must be 21 years of age by the time you're promoted to a deputy sheriff trainee, I mean, deputy sheriff one from a trainee. What's interesting, we do screen on this because there is California law that came out just a couple of years ago that to be in a sworn peace officer position, you need to be at least 21 years old. So it means that when one of our deputy sheriff trainees graduates from the academy, the next day when they are alternately promoted to a deputy sheriff one, they need to be at least 21 years old.
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
if I'm following right, the requirement to be 21 comes from California law.
California law.
But it doesn't show up in our minimum qualifications. Correct. So I suppose a challenge for you all in your work is sometimes you have a set of specifications that sets up these minimum qualifications, but then post-regulations change, a California state law changes, some other law changes, you have to comply with it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So then you have to, from your perspective as the HR professionals, keep track of multiple things on top of just your local requirements.
Yes, thank you for bringing that up, because we fortunately have in our civil service rules that if there is a state or federal law that we need to abide by, we can essentially use that as a rider over the top of the minimum qualifications and the specification that we already have.
And then in addition, if I follow your work correctly, when state or federal law imposes one of these requirements, you have to comply with that. And so the county of Sonoma could have a greater requirement, but not a lesser requirement.
Yes, correct. That is correct.
Yeah.
Okay. And so we do reflect that change in the job announcement that's posted online that people can apply to so that they can see what those current requirements are when they want to apply for the position. Like Amy said, some of the specifications, in this case, the specification still says 18 years of age. As we work on that project next year, we'll look at updating the actual job specification, but the job announcement that people are seeing when they want to apply for the position, that reflects the requirement that you have to be 21 years of age in order to apply and meet the qualifications to be at that deputy sheriff one level. Yes. And then if you are passing the academy, you have to be 21 at that time. Yeah.
And sorry to monopolize the conversation. Okay. Let me check one of the
things. Sure,
sure.
One of the things I think I learned when I went to the regional training academy the other day, regional training center, was that the requirement about being a U.S. citizen or permanent resident used to be a feature of California law and changed, I think, only as of January this year. So is that something that is actually written into our minimum requirements right now and need to be changed? Or is that there just because we're referencing state law?
So the law became effective in 2022 and then became operative as of January 2023. We really, like you said, we are really trying to stay up on our laws.
It's a lot.
And this has been very interesting. So there was an amendment to one section of that law that says that it can be reduced to a new standard, which is potentially a broader standard. The same law, the California government code, does still give agencies the opportunity or the ability, not the opportunity, the ability to have higher standards than that. And they're still working out all the kinks in how to apply that law going forward.
So we have continued operating with a higher standard at this point in time.
So they being the Civil Service Commission, or they being who?
It's actually at the discretion of the sheriff at this point in time. So it gives the appointing authority the ability to make the determination. And so that is something that is currently in place. We have had conversations and we continue to have conversations. And as we look at what the effects and the impacts are of those legal changes, I know that evaluation is still ongoing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And there's different post positions. There's different, sworn positions, and some are armed and some are not armed. And so there may have to be different considerations longer term for how these different positions, what criteria needs to be used.
And there are different federal requirements, yes, and state requirements. So it's kind of
We're figuring it out.
Tom, did you have a question?
Do you have a quote, the site for the government code section or the name?
1031.
Yeah. Amy spent a lot of time with 1031.
Government code section 1031 contains all the minimum requirements at state law for peace officers, whether you're deputy sheriff or police officer or
probation officer,
any number of other peace officer positions.
See, I think I say 1031 about once a day. So let's see. So we talked about deputy sheriff trainee, and please keep asking questions too. I want this to be an informative time for us being here and to share information. So the last one that I just wanted to mention was Correctional Deputy 1, which is probably has some of our highest vacancies right now and is really critical for us to fill these positions. And I know the Sheriff's Office is spending a lot of time and resources to fill these positions. So Correctional Deputy 1, the minimum qualifications include, again, need to be at least a high school graduate or have a GED. Need to be 18 years of age, so it's not the 21. We don't have the same criteria as we do for the deputy sheriff trainee.
Well, why is that? Why the difference?
So everything was 18 before, and John may know the code related to what it was for changing for the deputy sheriff trainee to 21. I think there was some thought that give people a few more years of maturity before they're a sworn peace officer. But I'm not 100% sure. That came on before I was with sheriffs, but I don't know the whole thought process behind it. So I don't know what also, like, I don't know how many 18-year-olds are hired also, because we're probably not getting into too much on the background. Lee Spencer and I aren't. But, you know, I'm sure that it might be difficult for an 18-year-old to be able to get all the way through the recruitment process and demonstrate the same maturity that maybe somebody that has a little bit more years of experience. So let's see. So being 18 years of age, then also similar to the deputy sheriff trainee, no felony convictions, nor be under formal probation supervision. And then lastly, the same, the U.S. citizen or permanent resident who's applied for U.S. citizenship. So that is on our specifications right now as well. So those are minimum qualifications that when we're developing recruitments and as we're getting applications, that's what we're looking for. But we thought we'd spend a little bit of time talking also about what we do for outreach and advertising for positions. How are we finding candidates? How are we helping to let candidates know about our positions? So we do have traditional online job boards. We find even our governmentjobs.com website, which is our main job site where we post all of our jobs. That, along with Indeed, are probably the two primary places people are learning, or at least telling us that they're learning about our positions from, that's what they're reporting in the recruitment materials. So then we also post on various professional organizations and community-based organizations as well, such as the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, the LOCN are some of the community-based organizations. Then we also utilize social media. Everything is posted, all of our job announcements are posted in Facebook, Glassdoor, Instagram, and we really also rely, Sheriff's has a great Instagram site as well. And so they also are actively posting the jobs there as well. And then we also have diversity focused sources such as workplace diversity and diversity jobs. And those are kind of central repositories where we can post our position and then they send it out to other niche diverse sites that they have
amongst their larger organizations. So those are really helpful for us to get the word out about our positions. And then every few months for some of our recruitments, we'll go and refresh the ads so that they kind of get back onto the top of searches. Because what we have found as we go more and more into posting jobs online, which is really the main place to post now, is that the algorithms, all these different sites use algorithms, and you kind of pay to play. And so you have to pay more money to keep positions at the top of the recruiting, at the top for the candidate's eyes to find. So we also do participate. Oh, yeah.
Question on that. Do you employ like SEO experts and assisting with that effort or not?
No. So it's all internal to on our team.
Amy's our SEO expert.
But we do think about that and about what words can we put into our recruitments, what are things that are going to appeal, what will be the search words so that they will try to trickle up to the top.
And as Amy mentioned, yeah. Most of it it's pay to play now. Every time you post with Indeed, they give you an amount and they'll say, you should really be spending $750, $800, $900 to get this ad seen by more people. Of course, they're telling all of their other customers this as well, right? So these amounts used to be like $400, a year or two ago. Now they're like $900. Facebook ads, boosting Facebook ads to be able to increase the population by which who are seeing the Facebook ads, and then working with other partners as well that we have to be able to kind of just blanket as many different websites as possible with our advertising. And that's really
how are you measuring the effectiveness of your ads?
So some of it, we have metrics within our system. We use something called NeoGov, which is our vendor for placing ads. So we have metrics from there. Google, we also pull metrics. We can pull metrics from there. And then also self-reporting. What are applicants telling us? So we put information in what we call the supplemental questions, and we put a list of where all the places are that we posted the ad, particularly where did we pay to post the ad, and is it working? Are they finding it from there? And what we still see is that people come directly to our website, to thegovernmentjobs.com, and through Indeed. And even while I was driving over here, I was listening to the radio, and it's interesting because you guys are going to be on the radio as well, and Indeed comes up as advertising. So radio is still effective to also get people to it's like dropping reminders in your mind to look there. I think we're also starting to see more use of QR codes.
Yeah.
And so I think in the next year, we'll probably be doing more with how can we effectively, where can we put banners, where can we put information to take advantage of people just using their phones to get that QR code and get to the right place.
NeoGov, the applicant tracking system that we utilize, is the most popular, or the largest applicant tracking system for public sector in the nation. And they do have a job board, Government Jobs, that comes along with it, which is the leading government jobs website in the nation as well. A large number of people who are interested in public sector employment use their job board, mm-hmm. and then just putting in law enforcement, Sonoma County, then it would populate jobs at the sheriff's office. I think Santa Rosa PD uses it as well. A lot of local agencies use their website.
So, John, you actually stole some of my thunder of what I was going to say about job fairs and community engagement. So first of all, just mention that we do go to a number of job fairs. During COVID, everything went virtual. And we've just started, particularly in the past year, trickling back to doing in-person job fairs. And just a couple weeks ago, I was at Santa Rosa Junior College. The sheriff's office was there as well. And it was a really well-attended in-person job fair. So that's definitely coming back. And even if people aren't ready to apply that day, it's just like we're in the community. We're part of the community. This is the place to apply and to stay in the community. So I think it's great that we're starting to go back to doing in-person job fairs. Recently, I was on a Sonoma State University career panel. So finding just different ways to let people know about working with the county and that we're here. And I'll be honest, when I was in my early 20s, I had no idea that the county was a place to have a career. And I'll share just personally, I just couldn't be happier having found a spot being at the county. So, and then community events, we'll have a table probably about once a month at the Wednesday night markets. And we're hoping to also participate in the county tabling this summer.
We haven't told Jeff, but HR is in at the fairgrounds.
Yes.
So you can mark us down. I haven't responded to the email yet. But yes, we are in as a department who wants to staff the fairgrounds. Yes.
Yay.
Yeah. And then we've got a table at Pride that's coming up in Pride June.
Bad news is, since you were one of the later departments to let me know, you're going to have to staff 5 days.
That's okay. We can do that. We can
staff. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Sounds like you can go hang out with the farm animals. That's my favorite part. We do try to get out to a number of different community events, but hearing Lizette and John talk about some of the other community events, it's like, oh, you know, there's even more opportunities. And, you know, maybe if HR can't go, we can give materials. And so being able to have some reciprocity amongst tables can be really helpful as well. So one of the tools that I mentioned that we now have that we're super excited to have is the hiring incentive pilot program that was approved by the board for the sheriff's office at the mid-December of 2022. And this is a recruitment tool to help keep people find ways to recruit and then retain, because there's a signing bonus component that is $25,000 to $30,000. The $30,000 level is essentially for deputy sheriff twos. So those would be lateral positions, people coming from other agencies, that would be the one that's eligible for $30,000 signing bonus. But our other job classifications that we've been discussing tonight are eligible for a $25,000 signing bonus that's paid over 3 years. Because we don't want to just give them $25,000 and have them leave the next day. We want to recruit and train and retain good staff. So then another component to our hiring incentive pilot program is a relocation assistance, which is up to $5,000 to help if they're going to be moving out of the area to come move to Sonoma County. And then there's also if they're eligible for advanced sick and paid leave advancements for a handful of hours.
Which if they can be coming from another agency and potentially are leaving a Marin County Sheriff's Office where maybe they have hundreds of hours of vacation, it's just a little something that we can provide them to kind of start off with some accrual benefits.
Yeah, and then Sean may have more information, but the Sheriff's Office has, I just wanted to mention, because I think I'm really excited to see what comes of it. The Sheriff's Office is doing a large marketing project that's going to be over the next 3 years, would you say, Sean?
Yeah.
So, and I'm excited to see what comes from that. I've seen some other agencies that have used the same outside agency that's going to be working with sheriffs, and I've been really excited with what I've seen. So, and also Sheriff's Office does a lot of community engagement and marketing, and almost every job fair that HR is at, Sheriff's has a table there as well. So I just wanted to mention that.
Can you tell me what SHF stands
for? Oh, I'm sorry. That was my sheriff's office. It's our internal
SCSO.
Okay. Thank you. And you know, that was didn't think about that when we were just trying to keep things short and concise here. So so after we've done our outreach and we've screened for minimum qualifications and we have our candidates who meet those qualifications, then they are invited to participate in an examination. Every recruitment has an examination. And for deputy sheriff trainee and correctional deputy one, we do those exams in central HR, and it's what we call pre-referral. So it means that the candidates are still kind of with central HR, and they have to go through an exam process before they're referred for an interview. And in this case, for deputy sheriff trainee and correctional deputy, it's also that there are California standards from BSCC and POST that require these examinations. And it's not testing, these exams aren't testing for things that they would be doing on the job, but it's more do they have those foundational entry-level skills that would be good indicators that they would be well qualified to do these positions. And if you can see in the bottom corner, I put a pencil with a Scantron. That's really the type of test that they're taking for deputy sheriff trainee and correctional deputy. It really is a pencil paper test. multiple choice style.
And as Amy said, and these are tests that we receive and we have to order from the post and from the SCC. They mail them to us. We have to administer them in a specific fashion. We box them up, we send them back, and then they send us back the scores. But we don't really have any latitude as far as changing this test at all or evaluating this test. It is required by these two agencies that this is the test that we are utilizing.
So, and then communications risk factor also has a test, but that test is done post-referral, which means that Central HR is screening for minimum qualifications, and then we're referring applicants to the sheriff's office, and then sheriff's office sends out links for the applicants to take the exam. That is a web-based test, so they don't have to do the pencil Scantron test for the communications dispatcher.
In the olden days, yes. So to speak, it used to be a Scantron test. And to try to simulate what was happening in dispatch, we'd play a CD. And so you'd listen to a CD while you were doing Scantron bubbling and try to keep track of everything all at once. Technology is, caught up. And so now there's actually, we use a test called Critical, which is actually a dispatch simulation test. So people actually get to go on, they're looking at a computer screen, which is similar to dispatch, they're hearing calls coming in. And it's a more realistic, real-life scenario that they're doing, which the system is then grading them essentially based on their responses. And that meets the requirements the post requirements for dispatch.
Yeah, and my contacts in the sheriff's office have said that they think that the hiring incentive has really helped, particularly with communication with dispatcher, because they are almost fully staffed. I'm almost afraid to say it out loud because I don't want to jinx it, but these have all been different classifications with high vacancy rates. So I'm really thrilled for them that it's almost fully staffed. But we still have the recruitment open. We don't want to close it yet.
So we heard.
They were there on Saturday.
And the dispatch said that they were down.
30.
Wow, that's really
good. Dispatch?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I wonder if maybe at the two level that they're seeing.
I don't know. They didn't distinguish between.
They had a new person who just started in January. She was still training. Did they mention that they were still short staffed?
I know they have some offers out for the entry-level dispatchers, and of course it'll be a while until those people are able to be on the floor and they've gone through the training program, and there might be some at the higher levels that are still vacant. But I know the hiring incentive they have told us has been helpful getting new dispatchers in.
They're basically in background, too.
Which is a really good segue to what I'm coming to. I was just going to say the regardless of which of these three job classifications you're applying for, everybody that meets minimum qualifications must pass an exam to be able to move to the next step in the process, and that's the selection process, which that is when everybody is with the sheriff's office and they're starting to go through the interview process post passing an exam. And then post that interview, when the sheriff's office has identified candidates that they are interested in moving forward past that initial interview, that is when they're going to go through a battery of pre-employment screenings that are going to include background and medical and physical agilities. But by that point, they're out of the central HR staffing or recruiting processes. So that's the information we wanted to share tonight. But we are open for questions.
Well, this came up before. And we were hearing it's like 6 months, even for dispatch, to get through this process. So from the test required by post, what's your guys' standard as far as how long does it take to get through your process? Then you go over to the next step. And tied into that, is there any way to hire people on a temporary basis at will, hourly wage only, no benefits, no union, just to fill vacancies? Because they're serious.
Do you want to talk about timing from a recruitment standpoint?
So from a recruitment standpoint, depending on when an applicant applies, we're doing the correctional deputy testing about twice a month. So usually once a month, it'll be on a weekday, and once a month, it's on a weekend. And so depending on when somebody applies, they could be invited to an exam within a few days. they could sit for the exam. We get the exam results back pretty quickly now, usually within 5 to 7 business days. And then we look at the data, analyze the data, the exam data, see if there's any issues. Usually there's not. And then we refer them over to the department. And then so that part, it could be 2.5-3 weeks that an applicant is with us. And then they're going through the sheriff's processes. And Sean, I don't know if you want to share about, you know, what about the process with the sheriff's office, because you mentioned doing extra help or at will.
To Tom's point, I think he's talking about the extra help employees, and that recruitment is open, from my understanding. And those are the hourly, no benefits, no unions.
So that is called extra help employment, and that is in our civil service rules. And there are a variety of types of extra help. There's temporary, in which someone can work for a year in extra help basis. There's also
intermittent,
where you can work up to 1,380 hours in a rolling 12-month period.
Do people apply and know about that? There's once they get through step one.
So let me just say this. So the background requirements for an extra help position are very similar to a permanent position. So for other types of recruitments at the county, typically outside of the sheriff's office, there are more extra help recruitments because it can be a way to get a clerical assistant in pretty quickly, or an administrative analyst position, or a department analyst position, because the county background process is, just a quick 7-year criminal background check, which we can do with our third party vendor, and it's pretty fast. The law enforcement positions, though, there are still the requirements that need to be met for post and state board of corrections and the dimensions that they have to meet. So it is not typically as advantageous for them to go down that extra help path because the timing doesn't significantly change for those individuals in that process. I do know that there is, the sheriff's office does utilize actually quite a few retirees in an extra help capacity, who, retired and then they want to come back and help out in maybe the courts or maybe working in the board chambers or something, and they utilize extra help.
Just a question. Yeah. I was just trying, is there any way to shortcut the process where you're not hiring them? Do you do all the testing?
Yeah.
But you're getting them working so they're not in other counties and they are understanding. If you don't pass the test, you're gone. But if you do, they've got a chance to work. You can see them work.
I don't know that way.
Yeah, and I think that might get a that might be hard to do because you basically put them out on the street with no background or medical.
I'm thinking dispatch.
I see what you're saying.
I think there's a lot of training still. They go through their own post classes, and I think there's still a pretty deep commitment to the entry level staff that are coming on, and it would be difficult to have somebody, I'm not sure, out of like pressing one or two buttons that they'd be really effective in those positions.
I was just gonna add that I think as a general rule in any law enforcement agency, the dispatchers actually have a very complicated, extremely technical job.
Yeah.
So for example, they have a variety of technologies they're using. Multiple screens to watch at the same time, multiple keyboards to manage, multiple communication lines simultaneously. So not just the phone from someone calling in a 911, but also trying to understand, is that coming from a landline or a cell phone? Where is it? And then communicating with the various law enforcement agencies they need to talk to. And sometimes they need to talk to someone who's going to provide medical assistance or someone who's going to provide a law enforcement response. And they have to know which ones to call, so there's some discretion, and they have to use that appropriately. So it is a remarkably complicated job. So you wouldn't want someone doing that job who didn't have substantial training, because lives are at stake.
Not only the skills, but they have to be certified through the state to operate CLETS terminals, access to confidential information. The requirement for that is a comprehensive background.
That's interesting. One of our pain points is actually the written examination process. We get a number of people who apply for the job. And as Amy said, we're testing multiple times a month right now. We've got day and we've got weekend options available. The amount of people who fall out of the process and don't show up for the written exam, or the number of people who don't sign up to take the written exam in the first place, it's amazing how high that that there is. And that's unfortunately, and that's one of the things that we keep looking at is how can we attract more people to take that written exam? Because even when we see higher applicant numbers, we still have a significant fallout in that stage of the process.
You got to have a dental assistant calling them today.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that. So one of the things that we've done in the past year was that with our vendor NeoGov, that our applicant tracking system, there was an additional add-on where you can do text messaging. And so before the written exams, I send out a reminder a couple of days before, like, hey, remember, there's a written exam coming up. So that can be helpful, particularly if they're local. But if people are applying from Ohio, we actually have had people fly in from other states to take our exams. And so I really appreciate that they do that. But sometimes there's people that they didn't realize that there was going to be an exam, even though we put it out there in our recruitment and our selection procedure that there is going to be an in-person exam.
And we do allow them to use the scores that they've received from other agencies within a certain amount of time. Post actually allows you to take your score. So if they went and took the test with Marin County, they could give it to us in Sonoma County, you know, within the next six months. Yeah. So that they don't have to come back and retest with us. We can just use that, and then we can refer them on to the department for interview.
So what's the average length of time from the date of the job posting until like that requisition being filled and they're starting on the job? What's that look like for these two positions?
So for the sheriff and the deputy sheriff training, yeah, it can be 6 months. And part of it with the deputy sheriff trainee is there has to be space in the next academy. So the sheriff's office, and correct me if I'm wrong, please, we reserve so many spots in the next academy. And so as people, and I know that the human resource liaison that works in the sheriff's office, she's my main contact in the department. She's paying attention to those numbers really closely about when the next academy. So like right now, the next academy is going to be in July. And I think that they have candidates that are going to be going into the July. So then now we're talking about the December academy. So for the deputy sheriff training, it's also about when that academy is going to be starting. But I would say that the background typically is about 6 months.
Yeah, the sheriff understands the hiring crisis. And so he's added a background investigator position. The hopes of adding another full-time. We utilize extra help employees to be background. So they're pumping them out quickly. Mm-hmm. I think Napa is the academy closed. And so the one in Windsor is competitive now. You know, you have agencies throughout the Bay Area that are sending recruits there. So we have a good relationship with them, thankfully, that we can reserve spots.
But it's not the background isn't as simple as just submitting somebody's name into like how we do for most standard positions and just getting a simple background. They do quite an in-depth background check.
Yeah, like for the average county employee, what's that timeline look like? Just as a comparison.
Typical like pre-COVID, like things have gotten a little more challenging since COVID with the end in front of it. Looking about 90 days approximately from the date of contacting human resources, submitting a requisition saying, I need to fill a position, that's opening your recruitment, going through that process, the exam process, closing it, referring it to the department for interview, then making their selection, putting the person through background references.
About twice as long.
Yes, if not a little bit longer. Yeah.
And is that like 10 years ago? Was it 6 months as well? Or has that number changed, or is it?
I actually think it may have gotten improved for the general side, because like I was the very first employee to be hired without having to go through the full medical screening. It used to be that every applicant
for non-law enforcement jobs, we've changed. Well, for all county positions, we went back several years ago and we revisited the pre-employment medical components of the positions. And if positions are
sedentary
or have limited physical impact, we have a disclosure process now where we give someone what's called the job demands analysis form, which they can see what the skills are required and what the essential functions are of the position and the physical demands are, and they can evaluate review the document and let us know if they have a need for accommodation. So for most positions now at the county, that form can be filled out. For positions that require any type of physical demands, though, there is either a pre-employment process with Kaiser, or depending on how physically demanding it is, we have a company that we work with called Futures that does physical agility testing. And that's what you're probably familiar with when you think of law enforcement, you know, running with the dummy and kind of climbing stairs and kind of being on the treadmill and doing all of those types of simulations.
Can I ask, Sean, can I ask you a question about the background? Where do the requirements come from?
From both, the government code, the penal code.
So it says that, you know, you have to contact all of the neighbors and you have to ask for 3 additional references, and that specific?
Yeah, I don't know. Don't quote me on those.
Yeah, I'm not saying
but
if that's specific,
yeah,
our specific whether I'm right or not about those specific.
Our backgrounds are guided by POST,
yeah,
and the penal and government code.
I'll give you an example. So every few years, POST makes those requirements more detailed, and over time they become more and more detailed. At first blush, I think some people look at some of those and say, wow, these seem really onerous and ridiculous, over the top, right? Like you were mentioning, Nancy, that talk to at least 3, you know, neighbors. And that has been a rule of thumb for a long time in those POST examinations. Sorry, POST background checks. I know that today POST says, in addition to that, one, meaning an agency like the sheriff's office, should ask any candidate for a law enforcement position the names of everyone they've ever dated, which might also at first glance sound like overkill. But the reason for that is that there have been several jurisdictions that hired people as peace officers who later turned out to have a history of domestic violence that just had never been the subject of an arrest or a prosecution. So it didn't show up in government databases in the way one might normally find it. But had one talked to the people they had dated in the past, you would have seen the pattern. So it turned out to be actually an important screening tool, but then that adds more time and work and effort, and it does feel intrusive for the candidate. So, you know, again, as I was mentioning at the beginning, all of these rules have some source. There was some specific need that the rule is designed to meet. On the other hand, the more rules you have, the longer it takes to hire people. So there is this sort of push-pull between, do you really want to create this rule, or is the thing you're guarding against maybe not sufficiently worrisome to justify the extra time? But, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I mean, in the private sector right now, there's a lot of experimentation within HR of lowering standards to increase the applicant pool. I don't know how, it feels like our hands are tied here to a degree that, I mean, I don't know how much you have, you know, an ability to be flexible because of these regulations, but is that something that's being discussed or?
So with these positions, we don't have much flexibility at all, right? Because there are the state requirements. That is something we're looking at with non-sworn law enforcement positions, is we're looking at all of the other positions of the county, right? What are those minimum qualifications? If we have a bachelor's degree, why do we have a bachelor's degree? Is it necessary that someone has a bachelor's degree? So looking at the experience, looking at the licensure, the certification. So that's part of what we are doing, is going back this coming year and going to reevaluate. Our hands are pretty much tied, though, with regards to these specific classifications, unless we see POST or State Board of Corrections making changes or state law.
Forgive me if you covered this already. Sure. I don't think I heard it, but if the sheriff's office wants to hire someone that we might call a lateral, someone who's worked in one of these positions in another agency, say another county, and already has some experience, does that change this process at all for them?
So no written exam. They don't have to go through the exam. And that is much more aligned with our standard county processes, where they're having to answer supplemental questions. And a lot of times it's tell us about your experience at the other agency, but they do still need to meet the other criteria, which, especially if they're within a California agency, they're going to already meet the those criteria. So, but it's more about tell us about your experience and making sure that they do meet the qualifications at the higher level.
And do those people, laterals, go through the same background?
Yeah,
investigation.
They go through all the same steps. In fact, it probably might even take a little bit longer, because now the background investigator has to go to the other agency that they came from and review their whole personnel file there. There's all other circumstances you wouldn't have that. Yeah, all the same requirements.
Okay.
And Sean, when your background investigators do that, I recall some years ago, a rule of thumb for a lot of background investigators would be actually physically go to that agency and look at the file in person. Is that still what they do?
Yeah, I can't speak for, you know, let's say out of state applicants, but certainly anybody within driving distance, they're physically going to the agency and reviewing their file.
Yeah, and laterals who are coming in from other agencies like that would sign a release to let such investigators look at anything that's in the file, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions? Max, sorry to come to you late. Do you have any questions?
No, I'm fine. Thanks.
Okay, so now we'll open it up for public comment. So if you could just stand up. You don't have to come to the middle of the room to speak loud enough, but we'll give you 3 minutes. And Nancy's going to unmute. So who'd like to go first? You could just stand up. We're on A still.
What I heard was this. Michael Hilker is my name.
Can you please stand up so that if you can be heard by the
microphone up here.
But I heard one of the disadvantages is working for the county is it's not part of CalPERS, so when people are paying into both the Social Security and the county pension, and it ends up being more taken out of the check versus if you're a city police officer, I think it would be 10% into CalPERS only and no Social Security. So are you getting any information that that's a competitive disadvantage to recruiting? So that's my question.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you for that information. I have not heard that that's been a concern for individuals. We are a 1937 Act. We have our own accounting retirement system, and we also do pay into and receive Social Security. I know the city of Santa Rosa does not pay into Social Security. I haven't heard that that's been a specific issue or concern that anyone has cited through our part of the process. I don't know, Sean, if that's something that you ever hear from.
Yeah, that comes up with laterals that aren't used to paying that. They look at their check and they see that 6.5% Social Security deduction. I think it's 6.5%. And it's a shock to them. They didn't know it initially. But
I guess what I meant is some other sheriffs do pay into CalPERS. They are still.
Ours don't, but they can also establish reciprocity. So depending on how long they have been in that other system, they can work with the Retirement Association here at Sonoma and have that time count either when they're coming into us or if they're leaving us and going to another jurisdiction, that time can count towards them. So I know CalPERS and our agency have a lot of reciprocity to help kind of make that a seamless transition as possible.
Okay. Who else wanted to provide public comment?
My name is Alchina Horstman. I was very interested to hear about the written test part and also that you were making a large focus on looking for barriers for diversity and employment. And it is very obvious to me that a lot of people would drop off for the testing. And so I was hoping that even if you feel your hands are tied for a lot of things that are required, that you would still delve into those and explore those very deeply and see if those are the barriers. Because if they are, even if your hands are tied, you can still present those results and like you
did
about that.
Yeah, it's a great question. Thank you very much. I think we do look at how we can remove the barriers that people have from a written testing standpoint. A number of years ago, we tried testing one night during the week to see if we had a better response there. As Amy mentioned, we have testing right now during weekdays, and we're testing once or twice a month on a weekend to see if we're getting more people showing up then. So we are looking at different options available to us. There is an online testing process now. We have not implemented it at this point in time. During COVID, there was an online testing process for some other positions. We found there to be a number of challenges with it. It still has to be an online proctored test It's not something we can send you a link and you can do at home. There's someone watching you do it, making sure that you have a clear desk surrounding you. It has to be at a very specific time. And so we hadn't found, as we practiced and tried that during COVID, there ended up being a lot of barriers. People's cameras cut off, there were issues, and then it created a lot of issues. So we are trying to continually see if there are other ways that we can entice people to come to the written exam, or what types of schedules we can offer for people to come. It is a numbers game as well. One of the challenges that we have is it takes, you know, as we talked about, it takes many months to get a position and to start a position. A number of these job classifications have lower minimum qualifications than a number of other positions of the county, you know, from an education experience standpoint. This is not a job you can apply for, and we're going to have you start and you're going to get paid in a month, right? This is a job that you are applying for and you need to be looking for in the long term. It's also about getting people early enough in their career. And I know we have this 21 year of age requirement now, but it's starting to get people to be thinking about this when they're in high school, right? I mean, it's, you need to start getting in front of individuals early enough so they start thinking about, what do I want to be when I grow up? How do I make the right life choices when I'm younger, so I'm not going to be disqualified from a background standpoint if I have a wild and reckless and crazy youth? And it's getting people interested in this from a career perspective. So we are trying to see, you know, as Amy said, we have, and we didn't actually show you, we encourage you to all go to the website. We do have the recruitments are posted. We have them open on what we call a continuous basis. So 24/7, they're on the website. People can apply at any time. We don't shut them down right now. We just keep them open. And then, as Amy mentioned, we're referring, or we're screening applications on a weekly basis. And then we are inviting people to the written exams, and we're trying to have those exams very frequently. And if someone misses one, they can come to the next one. Please.
My question very briefly.
Sure. Okay. Oh, sorry.
Sure. I'm actually fixated on more the psychological barriers rather than the physical barriers. So I'm fixated on the content of what's in there and how you prepare people for the content and the questions. And people I know that would be very resistant and scared to actually try to take the test and might drop out for that reason, not because they can't access it.
Okay.
So So one of the things, so we have the standards, the state standards that we can't get around. But to your point, and I get that, I myself am not a good test taker. I have a child with learning disabilities, where those can be barriers to take exams. So we can't get around those, the requirement. But one of the things that happens every time we invite the next pool of applicants, there's a box that says, do you need accommodations? Anybody that checks that box, they can provide, we don't need to know what their diagnosis is. We just need a letter of what their accommodations are. And then we align and provide those same accommodations when somebody's taking the exam. So if they need a private room, if they need those other accommodations, and that is confidential, just in central HR.
I won't belabor the point further than this last one. It's not about checking the box to say, I need accommodations for a disability. It's about racial, cultural, language, psychological barriers, and hoping that you will explore that and find a way to let people know, here's the content, this is the kind of thing we're looking for, not do I need an accommodation because I have a learning disability. So I just want to make sure that I'm very, very clear about what I'm diving into. And even if you cannot, even if your hands are tied, if you review it and research it and dive into that area, you can bring it back to the powers that be. I'll leave it alone from there.
Thank you. Thank you. I think I got where you're going. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Go ahead, Jim. And if you could try to get all your questions at once, please.
And just a reminder, the Brown Act provides us with a comment period, not a Q&A period.
Just start off saying that.
So we're really not supposed to.
I'm just going to start off saying thank you for allowing us to ask questions as the public. Since 2016, the CAC has gone back and forth. There have been times when it's allowed questions and times when it's not. And I very much appreciate you allowing us to ask questions this evening. And my questions actually are for Sean, and it's it's a twofold, and they're related. One is, do you guys track where, once somebody's been referred over to you guys from HR, they drop out of the process? Like, are we losing everybody in background? Is it medical? Is it physical? Like, just so you know where your barriers are, so you have data on that. And then, what is your sense to where are you losing most of your candidates?
I'll just go back to how I opened up this meeting. Is I don't work in that unit. I'm not the right person to answer that question. I don't want to speculate on where people are dropping out. Sorry.
Not a problem. Thank you.
Any other public comment? Go ahead.
My question relates to, I understand the county has been, and also the sheriff, part of the county, has a really hard time because of the cost of living in the old building, the cost of housing. And so I was just wondering if you guys could tell me what percentage of the sheriff's department employees actually live in the county. And I know that the program is very early on the bonus, but are you seeing that as a help to get people to actually live in the communities and, you know, become members of the community where they work? And so that's the question.
I would say it's early to tell all the data with the new hiring incentive pilot program, because many of the applicants are still in the background process that were eligible. So I don't know if we have a percentage. So I don't think we have a percentage of who live in the community.
It's a good question though, but it's not information that we have with us today.
Thank you. Seeing as nobody else would like to address the panel, we'll close public comment and we'll bring it back to the council for any final points of discussion. Well, thank you so much for your presentation. We really appreciate
thank
it.
You. Have a good day.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. So we'll move on to item 70, which is the discussion and possible action to establish an ad hoc on recruiting and hiring. And this was mentioned at our last meeting, where from the retreat, there was interest in establishing an ad hoc on related to stock data, and then now an ad hoc on recruiting and hiring. And we'd like to know if there's something done with that and which CAC members would like to join that ad hoc. And we could be on multiple ad hocs, correct? If we wanted to, as long as you don't have a quorum. So keep that in mind.
I think this is such an ingrained system, the chance that we could come up and help and make any change somewhere between zero remote. And just taking this on and just listening to what we heard, it's a lengthy process. You can't cut out, you can't do temporary hiring to get in. I wouldn't be thinking that could have any value.
If you don't mind, I'll push back on you a little bit.
Sure.
So, yes, there are some parts of this process that can't be changed because state law requires them. That said, there are some parts that we heard a little bit about that could be different. One conversation we had was, how do we encourage people to take tests, right? How do you encourage people to get interested in this line of work when they're quite young? And there are other agencies that do work to recruit people at a young age and make them interested. We talked about signing bonuses, hiring bonuses is one of them. Some places will put together what they might call a cadet program, where they have young people who are volunteers come in and work with the agency on a volunteer basis, get to know it a little bit and become inspired to join. There are Explorer Scouts who were actually at the event that Lizette and I attended over the weekend with the CHP. And so it's akin to Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts, but they're slightly older youth, usually 16 to 20 thereabouts, who try to learn what it's like to be in law enforcement, and then they become acquainted with some of the law enforcement agencies and become more interested in applying. There's the issue we talked about citizenship status. The state's opened up a window for us there, and it sounds like there's conversation in Sonoma County right now about whether to take advantage of that window or not. And we know anecdotally some other agencies are reporting that's really diversified their applicant pool. Whether that works for Sonoma County or doesn't work is another question. We did not have enough time tonight to get into the question of how backgrounds are done and who gets dropped out or who gets included as the background investigation goes forward. And there's some state rules there, but there's also some discretion there. And then there are people who we didn't have time to get to this tonight either because it's a complicated question, but there's also an extensive training program that happens during the probationary period when someone's a new employee. And some people fail out as a result of that, and some people make it. Looking into how that process works might be a factor too. So, and I know also we talked very briefly about laterals, but there are some communities that have talked about whether there might be ways to encourage more laterals to come over and whether or not the community feels that the laterals being hired meet community standards, right? Like there is some discretion about what one learns about their prior employment that might cause you to really want to hire someone or really not want to hire someone, and different agencies have different opinions about that. We didn't get into that detail yet either. So I think there's a lot about the qualifications that are set by state law, but I wouldn't let that dissuade you from feeling that you can make a difference there.
Well, you and I have both spoken about this before. I think there are other people perhaps we'd be much better trying to find high school kids or college kids and try to convince them rather than pay to go to JC, let someone pay you, try to get them in Kathy. With this 6-month gap, and I just don't see myself as being part of a community that even with changing the citizen requirements, I could communicate enough to get any interest from the board to help.
Yeah, housing is another thing that crossed my mind too, just listening. I mean, I didn't realize there was 4,000 full-time equivalents at the county. Which is, I mean, I knew they were a large employer, but I didn't realize it was that big. And I know, I mean, I know smaller employers, private employers are looking at housing their own staff, and they're much smaller than 4,000 FTEs. So that was another area I thought maybe, you know, I didn't want to get it too far afield when they were talking about it, but I imagine that's something they must be looking at. If they're not, we can encourage them to do that. I mean, housing is such a huge barrier here, and I don't see that changing anytime soon. So might just be one more kind of perk, you know, in terms of a bonus and, you know, recruiting younger people to come on board.
Would anyone from the public like to comment on this proposal to create an ad hoc on recruiting and hiring?
Yeah, I was really hoping you were going to have an ad hoc on hiring and recruitment, because I think even if you find one little area for change, that can make a huge difference in bringing folks in, depending upon what that area is. And we've got a crisis going with the sheriff's office. You know, the amount of mandatory overtime is just not healthy for our law enforcement employees, which makes it unhealthy for our community. And you're the CAC, you should be working on this, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Ready?
Go ahead.
Michael Hilbert, I would just a no. I think you're overstepping. Yeah. Eddie Ingram is the elected leader of the sheriff's office. It's his right and his duty to set policy, including over hiring. And to the extent there's any discretion, that's his authority to exercise. And I will remind you that none of you were elected, so if you all want to involve yourself in this, is there a principle of his authority? So I would say just give it a month.
All right, thank you for your comment.
Can I?
Oh, we don't have anyone. Yes, go ahead, you have 3 minutes.
Yeah, just as a counterpoint. I would recommend that you do this. And I don't view this as adversarial. I feel like it's the chance to really partner with the sheriff's office. We as a community know they're really struggling to maintain their staffing. And anything we can do to support them in doing that collaboratively, I think it's just more minds around it. And I think it's important that they understand what the community is thinking, that the community does support them in getting to full staff. And so I wouldn't view it as a negative. I actually view it as a positive working condition.
Thank you. And with that, we'll close public comment and bring it back to the CAC. So I will add one last comment. They kept mentioning Marin, and I actually work in Marin, not for the county, but every agency that I work with, they always mention the same issues, and they've kind of brought up that Sonoma County's stealing their candidates and things like that. So I know it's kind of an issue everywhere. I did hear Central Marin Police Authority brought up that $25,000 to $30,000 bonus. So every agency is kind of trying something different. So in my opinion, I think it would be helpful that we look into different things that could be proposed from what we do have the ability to do. And that could be something that the ad hoc can look into by doing research on, you know, what other agencies are doing nearby, and from hearing what we do have the ability to contribute to, because it seems like they have a lot of standards already that they have to follow. So well, those are just my two cents. But if no one's prepared to join an ad hoc right now, we could bring this back next month, right? But we do intend.
I was volunteer to serve on it.
Okay, so we have Nancy who's interested.
I will too.
Nathan. And we can wait to bring it back again. We are missing Marcy and Evan. So we'll see if they're interested. And then it gives you a little bit more time to kind of observe everything that we're doing. This is kind of a long meeting today, but.
Well, in one minute, I'll note also, if you don't mind, Madam Chair, that you can always add more people to an ad hoc later. Mm-hmm. You know, you could have a couple people get started, and if other people aren't here tonight, I'll have to do one later. That's just fine.
Okay. So we have two people getting it started for now. Thank you so much for volunteering. So now we'll move on to item C, which is a discussion and possible action on the proposed changes to the CAC's commitment to civil engagement and design team alliance. So as you might recall, probably Jim might remember when we first started our like single in-person meeting with Carlene, and she had hired someone to help the CAC create what became the commitment to civil engagement and design team alliance, which is what Nancy read at the beginning of the meeting. And we didn't typically read it before, but we started making it a practice. And it seems like there's a lot of repetitive information. So at last month's meeting, we proposed to shorten it, but still keep the purpose of what it was created for. And so in the agenda packets, we have the draft of what we're proposing to be the commitment to civil engagement. And we'll open it up to the CAC for questions. It's on
the last page.
It's the last page in the agenda packet. Mm-hmm. If you had a chance to review, do you have any questions? And if there are no questions, we'll open it up for public comment and then bring that item for a possible vote or discussion. Hey, seeing there's no question, Max, do you have any? Okay, perfect. Oh, sorry, Siri, interrupting me. So we'll go ahead and open it up for public comment. So if you'd like to speak on the draft, Nancy's going to time you. You have 3 minutes. Okay.
My only thing is the thing with no gestures. We would have applauded for the HR folks, but we were like, oh, we don't want to violate the design team alliance. You know, that's a gesture. So, I think it could be shortened and made clearer. You know, if we're going to allow gestures of support, then you have to allow gestures of disagreement. And so then we're left with no gestures whatsoever, which I think violates the spirit of what we're trying to do with a community body. But I, you know, have gestures, but don't be a jerk, you know. And then,
can you draw?
Sorry. Okay. Thank you, Jim. So I'll bring it back to the CAC. Any comments? I would be okay with if you all would.
I have something. Yeah. I think of gestures as things that don't have sound. Whereas clapping and booing has sound. It seems like gestures should be fine, but it's if they don't have sound, you know, gestures that don't have sound. The things that don't, you know, like things like that, that's a gesture, doesn't have sound. I think it's a sound that gets disruptive.
So jazz hands and approval is good. Clapping, not
yeah.
So what would you say, Max?
So I guess I would revise that to say, I would just say to have their say without comment or intrusive sounds, something like that, such as booing, whistling, or clapping.
I don't think we need to look at the round for that.
Well, no, because I did one. Someone said something and I gave a thumbs up. Later on, realized that was back during Zoom time. I went, hey, good point.
I think those are okay. I haven't heard anyone be dismissive of those. Sometimes it's better than just interrupting with verbal comments, the clapping or the other symbols that Zoom lets you do. I've seen a lot of people do them. So I think Max's comment or suggestion is good. We'll eliminate gestures, as was also suggested by the board.
So we now allow others to speak without comment or intrusive sounds.
Yeah, sounds good.
Thank you. Secret.
So, is everyone up there? If you're okay with it, we need a motion to approve as amended. Did you want to add a such as to the?
No, we just did that.
Okay.
Give her a negative sound effect.
So we have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor? Say aye.
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 Aye. Good. Everyone voted. Okay.
So. I thank you for not making me to read that. Very
long.
But it is.
Still read it. Absolutely. It'll now be the approved version.
Much easier.
Much more concise.
Okay. Then item D is discussion of possible action regarding proposed change in location and date of the regularly scheduled meetings of the CAC. Can I turn it over to staff on this for
sure
specific?
I'll start by saying that your bylaws call for a regular meeting of the first Monday every month. There's been some discussion about moving to a different date. One of the reasons that has been floated for doing that is that our local NAACP chapter also meets the first Monday of every month at the same time. And so the thought was, well, maybe we should pick a different date because that doesn't seem very inclusive, right? So in addition to that, we post-COVID have been experimenting with location. And I think we've gotten some positive reviews about our current location. Third thing to think about here is that the Brown Act approach to setting your meetings comes from 20th century traditions that one would physically post a notice of a meeting. And that there would be some schedule, a calendar of meetings that would be physically available in a county center or the like, that people would read, and then they would conclude from there where the regularly scheduled meetings of any group were so that they could regularly show up. Clearly a pre-internet rule. That said, it's still the rule that we have not only a regular meeting time, but a regular meeting date and a regular meeting location. So we're supposed to set that as our norm so that people can expect when and where to find us. It is okay on a periodic basis to change those so long as one provides advance notice
that the given meeting will be at a different time or a different place or a different location. So what we're looking at doing here is changing the regular meeting per the Brown Act by amending our bylaws to switch to another date if this body so chooses. And I have heard some members of the CAC suggest perhaps a different Monday. And I think Lizette and I could accommodate almost any time that you might pick, but some other Monday would be fine with us. And that would relieve us of the NAACP conflict issue. I will just flag that if we want to make the regular location here, one caveat is that we do not ultimately control this room. It doesn't belong to directly the county or to ILARA or even the sheriff's office. So it is possible the Sonoma Office of Education, which does control the space, might every now and then need it for something else. So they have very politely, but directly said, we cannot guarantee that you would always have this room and every day you might want it. But they've been extraordinarily cooperative, helpful, and given us lots of advance notice in the past. So if we were to pick this location as the regular location, I would just say we would all need to be prepared for the idea that there might be on occasion a meeting that we might have to reschedule and call it a special meeting and have it somewhere else. I recall the CAC pre-COVID liked to, on occasion, meet in other locations anyways, just for the sake of getting out to different parts of the community and making the meetings more accessible. So maybe that isn't such a big deal because we might want to meet in some other places in the South County or over in the Sonoma Valley or over in West County or the north part of the county or what have you. So I think that's a pretty good summary of everything I have heard about this issue so far, and I'm sure CAC members might want to add some other thoughts.
That's good. I mean, I think second or third Monday works just as well, right? Hopefully the second Monday, I think would be the best. But I'm open to the meeting.
Okay. I like the second Monday.
I think since our chair should find that be helpful.
I will not always be chair, so.
Yeah, but you don't have to do this beyond you being chair either if we don't want to.
I do like the idea of moving around. I mean, I think Sonoma makes sense. I mean, around the county, but it definitely makes sense. But big county. Would SCO give us a lot of notice as far as which dates don't work if we did post this calendar out
forward, or? My recollection, Lizette, you tell me if I have this right, is that they ask us to talk to them 6 weeks out.
They want 6 weeks out for reservations, and they prioritize their meetings before
them. Okay.
So I suppose they wouldn't approve a calendar in advance, but we'd have at least 6 weeks notice that the date didn't work.
Yeah. Okay. How much notice would we need for a different location? I guess that's hard to know. But...
Well, on the staff end, we would definitely need some time because we would need to go find it, figure out what it is. So suggestions CAC members have about alternate locations now would be helpful so we could at least get to know those spaces, right? Maybe not necessarily at this meeting, but email them to Lizette. And so we can create a little library of alternate meeting locations.
Yeah.
And Max, if you have any, same for you.
Are you okay with
saying? Are there any in Casadero, Max?
Not that I know of. I'm fine with whatever Monday is. It's fine with me.
Has anyone checked with the sheriff's office? They've got many conference rooms there. As a fallback, we don't have this location.
A thought I've heard from some people is, sure, we should use the spaces at the sheriff's office, and they do have a really pretty good meeting space that's roughly the size of this one, maybe a little bigger, on the first floor. I have had some people in the community say they'd rather not meet at the sheriff's office just because some of the people who want to come talk to us have had a negative experience, and so they feel more comfortable being in a neutral space.
Yes. So we could open this item up for public comment if anyone from the public would like to speak. We have 3 minutes.
Okay, my name is Robin Jures, and I actually have been appointed to CAC and will start next month. And this second Monday doesn't work very well for me. It would mean not going to another regular meeting that I go to. So the third would work, but I'm not going to, I'm like, before I even see that, I'm not going to be saying too many demands. But I would also say, I don't know if this is their experience, but I find it more difficult to hear in this room as an audience member. And maybe if the seat chairs were just moved up a little closer, that would help. But I think it might be the fabric. I don't know what it is about this room, but I found it more difficult to hear in this room than I did when I was at the retreat, for instance. It's a smaller room. But anyway, those are just two. I mean, I think the first one is probably pretty important to finally see the numbers.
What district are you in?
I'm sorry?
What district are you appointed from?
Susan Gorin.
Great.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
Yes, Altina Horstman again. I would like to say any Monday is great. I totally support JDG and the NAACP members to come. But I think I really like this location, but you need a car and it's really far away and it is not accessible. So I do not like this location. I think we should use something like the library in downtown Santa Rosa. And I like the idea of moving it all around the county, but always somewhere central where people don't need vehicles. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the only comment I have, I know you guys are talking about a Monday, but if it is a goal to get the Board of Supervisors more engaged in what you're doing at the CAC, since they always meet on a Tuesday, usually they or their district directors are, it would be really hard for them to do on Monday or Tuesday because they're usually prepping the board meetings. So I know you guys are talking on Monday, but I just wanted to throw that out. And also, I don't know if that is an objective of yours. Certainly an objective of mine, but it may not
be yours. Thank you. Did you want to comment as well?
Well, I only just objected to Tuesday because that's when all the other meetings, like the Santa Rosa County launch. I'm sorry, I missed some of the discussion.
That's okay. Thank you. So we'll bring it.
I don't know why I
started. It's going to work for me either because I actually have council meetings to attend and manage, so I wouldn't be able to come.
Was it Thursday?
Is there another day for you?
I think we could talk about it offline and then bring, like, put in writing the options that we have, maybe, so that that was kind of my intent this anything. Time, but.
I don't have anything more I can tell you about options than what I've already told you. And this we could do that, but you'll get a memo saying the same thing I just told you. I don't mean to be disrespectful. It's just there is no other information. We've been trying for 6 months to find other locations and none of the other ones that we've discussed tonight work. There are reasons why we can't use the library. We can't use the room from the retreat in the future. So since those are not available, this is the only room we have for you after 6 months of looking. And we also have total flexibility about the night of the week. Yeah, it's just up to you to pick whatever.
The location, to me, this is fine, actually.
So I did check some other organizations or commissions. So like the Commission on Human Rights meets the fourth Tuesday, and that's probably a commission we don't want to be in conflict with. As does the Community Action Partnership. The Commission on the Status of Women meets the second Thursday, and the Civil Service Commission meets the first and third Thursdays at 3:30.
So sounds like Wednesday is a meeting.
Yeah, I know that Wednesday works for you, doesn't work for you sometimes.
The third Wednesday would not work for me. And then, and actually, I also help the Marin Emergency Radio Authority, so not every month I have the fourth Wednesday that I can't do, and because there's a meeting there, the third Wednesday as well. Every other month it's the second Wednesday, and every 3 months it's the third Wednesday as well for two meetings. So Wednesdays are bad for me, but
first Wednesday is okay.
But first Wednesday,
how about first Wednesday?
Yeah,
first Thursday.
Yeah, or you can do that.
On Thursday night?
The first Thursday, the Civil Service Commission meets, but it's at 3:30.
Oh.
So that's not really a conflict. The 6 o'clock is. You want to go to that, it'll be a long day.
Yeah.
So should we bring it back for a vote next month when Evan and Marcy are here for either the third Wednesday, you said you were, yeah, I mean, first. Third Monday, you said you were okay with it because she can't do second Mondays, and then first Wednesday or first Thursday, and then we'll vote.
Yeah, so just write that down so we don't forget. So
yes. Third Wednesday, first Thursday.
Third Monday. First Wednesday or first Thursday.
And what was the other one?
Third Monday. Mm-hmm. First Wednesday or first Thursday. Okay. So that's three options.
Yeah. That's enough options. And I didn't think we want more Board of Supervisors potential participation. So that is definitely a goal, I think, for me. I don't know if that.
Yeah, I believe we do let them know of our meetings.
I did send them the agenda, all four or five. And all five.
I did speak to Rabbit. He mentioned Monday nights. No way. Right. Tuesdays.
So first Wednesday, first Thursday, third Monday, and then we could list specifically in the agenda for the next meeting that those are the three options upon which we're voting, so all the members know that those are the three options.
Yeah. And sorry for the confusion. I was wanted the specifics on dates, the location. I already knew you guys have been working hard on getting, and then it's also difficult since we're doing hybrid meetings that not everything, every location has technological options. Yeah. Okay, so I think we're done with our business items. And
can I make one more comment? And that is in response to Alcina's concern about about transit and being available. We offer an accommodation for Spanish speaking. Say if you need an interpreter, let us know. How about asking if you need a ride, let us know
on the agenda.
On the agenda, and we could take it from there.
How would we provide the ride?
Carpools.
I'll give a ride. We have a liability issue. We do.
I don't know any other board or commission in Sonoma County that does that, and there's probably a reason why. I think we might want to find out what that is before we offer it. I like the idea, but just the lawyer in me has thought of six reasons why I might not want to do that.
Yes.
And also we
do have Zoom. Yes.
Although we do apologize for the issues today, but I think for people who can't drive here, they could participate via Zoom or call in.
But if you would like, Nancy, I'll ask about
pros
and cons and things to consider.
Okay. I mean, I can think of reasons too, but it's just
the lawyer.
Yeah. Dang lawyers.
Okay.
I'm trying to recover from that change. It takes a long time.
There's never full recovery. I'm sorry.
No. It's permanent brain damage.
Any other comments? Okay, we'll move on to committee reports. Finally getting close to the end. Community engagement committee.
So we have nothing to report in my two other community. I don't know that you heard from them about.
I did not. I believe we do not have the first meeting set yet.
Right. And we're trying to figure out if we can set a regular meeting since it's a standing committee. So it's open, has to be open to the public. So we want to have a standard time. A regular time, maybe on a quarterly basis, so that we could meet publicly on a quarterly basis. But we haven't gotten very far on this particular item. I do want to encourage people, if you have ideas about the different, I think we want to do more than just events. I think there are other things that we want to be able to do. And if you have ideas about things that we ought to be doing, I would encourage you. You can contact me directly or contact me through Lizette, so that we can get ideas from other people. I think there's a lot that can be done that we're not doing yet.
Thank you. Extremism and policing.
Yes, so that ad hoc is essentially wrapping up. Our last to-do kind of item was meeting with the liaison or sheriff himself or Lieutenant Nagel, is that, or Captain Nagel, am I saying his title correctly? So we were trying to get in contact with someone over there. It did not work out over this last month, and that was a little bit frustrating for us, but we are going to basically formalize the policy. I think make a couple more efforts to reach out and meet in person. But I think the work is essentially done. It's just really a matter of communicating what those policy recs are and talking through some of the options. But we need, you know, we need a partner to discuss that with. So that's what we're looking for.
I hear.
Okay. We'll do it. I'll reach out.
Okay. Racial and identity profiling app. Who wants to report? We did meet. we had a meeting last week, and we first wanted to kind of go over the kinds of questions we wanted to ask to get an idea on how the data collection actually works. So we're working on drafting something that would get sent out to our liaison, correct?
The assistant chair.
The assistant chair.
Sean. We'll take it.
Sean. Okay, so we're going through Sean to get that to the assistant sheriff to get kind of some answers to some of our questions and then go from there so that way we can see what we want to focus on and get a better understanding of the different kinds of stops and what triggers data collection that does get sent to the DOJ and things like that. So we'll have more to report next month. So now we'll move on to item 9, open time for public comment. If there's anyone from the public that wishes to address the CEC on any matters not on the agenda, you have 3 minutes. And we don't have anyone online, so we will close open time for public comment and move on to item 10, request for future agenda items. There will be one that you'd like to have on a future agenda.
I think that when we next month, when we do the meeting, I think we should also be prepared to, you know, when we decide where we're moving, what night we're moving the meeting to, I think we should also be prepared to do the bylaw change at that time so that we can just make this happen so we don't like to drag it out. So I would suggest that we add that as part of the agenda. Changes to the bylaws because we've got that.
You and I can work on that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
The bylaws do provide what we're doing now violates the bylaws, right?
Yeah. And then we did find a section that needed some cleaning up in regards to hybrid meetings. Okay. So Nancy and I will work on that. So now we'll move on to item 11, adjournment, and it is now 8:19. Our next meeting will be on Monday, June 5th at 6 p.m.
Here
in this location, and then we will see you all then. We will do what we can to test the Zoom information so that we don't have any communication issues next month. Thank you for being here. This meeting's adjourned.
So,
I think I just have a leap, right? Yeah.